Take time to be holy. Speak up with thy love. Abide in him always. And feed on his word. Make friends of God's children. Help those who are weak. Forgetting in nothing. His blessing to seek. Take time to be holy. The world rushes on. Spend much time in secret with Jesus alone. By looking to Jesus, like him thou shalt be. Thy friends in thy conduct, his likeness shall see. Take time to be holy. Let him be thy guide. And run not before him, whatever betide. In joy or in sorrow, still follow thy Lord, and looking to Jesus, still trust in his word. Take time to be holy, be calm in thy soul, each thought and each temper beneath his control. Thus, led by his Spirit, the fountains of love, thou shalt soon be fitted for service above.
Let us pray. Almighty Father, we are so grateful unto you, the God of love, the God of forgiveness. Divine, we thank you because of the word of forgiveness that you have sent unto us. You want to forgive us. You want to restore us. You want to reconcile us to yourself. Therefore, Father, I'm requesting this word that you have sent unto us, may it be understood by your people in Jesus' name. May your people be attracted to you by this word. May they draw closer to you to seek your forgiveness, to obtain your new life, to enjoy eternal life. Lord, I thank you for answering our prayers. In Jesus' name we pray. We are considering the message with the title, Blessed is he whose sins are forgiven. Blessed is he whose sins are forgiven. In the book of Psalm 32, verse 1 and 2. Psalm 32, verse 1 and 2. Blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man unto whom... And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father. I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe, and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf, and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead, and is alive again. He was lost, and is found. And they began to be merry. Now, sin deceived this young man and removed him from the father's house of peace, plenty, and pleasure. Sin is a deceiver. Sin is promising you a life, that life will be better. Sin is making a forbidden thing to look very sweet and nice. Sin is making some stories to look so real and true. Some imageries look as if they are real. That's what sin can do. Sin deceived this man. He was living in peace, living in joy, enjoying the father's honor and respect, because the father was a noble man. And people respected the father. The father had servants. People respected the father. The father had property. That's why he could even share things between the two sons. But with all this joy, the servants respected him. His brother loved him. They were all together in the father's house in peace. But he started hearing stories over there. Life will be better away from his father's house. Life will be better. You will have your liberty. You will have the things as you want. You can enjoy the things as you want. That's the language of sin. That's the promise of sin. Sin took him to a far country, very far away from his father. A far country of destitution. He became a destitute person. Person that is abandoned. Abandoned. Destitute. That's what sin did to him. Carry him somewhere. It's just like a mighty water flowing, carrying some things and abandoned those things somewhere. That's what sin did to him. Carried him and went and abandoned him somewhere. That's what sin do. A far country of disappointment. There was a promise that it will be better if you go there. If you do this thing, it's going to be better for you. And he went there and saw that life was not as sin was telling him. Life was not as the sin in his life was suggesting to him. He got disappointed. Very much disappointed. Disappointed by men and by God. Again, he was taken to a life of disaster. It was dangerous life. Sin took him to a dangerous course and abandoned him. Took him to a place and pushed him down. He was alone. He was in disaster. Sin, in fact, meant to destroy him. I want you to understand what sin. When it begins to give you promise, if you can, this woman, you can lie with women as you want, you can get as much money. This, you won't know what is inside. It's emptiness. Emptiness. After Solomon had gotten all those women, he said, vanity of vanity, all is vanity. After Solomon has gotten all those pleasures, he said, vanity of vanity, all is vanity. Sin is deceiving you, taking you to a place of emptiness. You will do all those things and not find life, not find reality. That's what sin did to that person. He suffered desertion of men. His friends left him. After they had exhausted his money, everybody abandoned him. Even to greet him, they were not greeting him again. Even when he greeted, who answered his greeting so he could draw closer? No. Sin took him and left him in a desert land where men could not even bother about him. He could not find food, even the foot of pigs to eat. Starvation. Sin brought starvation to his life. Poverty. That's what sin has done. Sin brought poverty to his life. So, can you understand that? He's falling down on him. Thank God for that boy. He sat down and talked through and said, I was a foolish person. How foolish was I that I was living in peace in my father's house? And a thought can just come to me and remove me from there. I was very foolish. I'm telling you, I was a fool. His foolishness downed upon him. But, you see, how foolish was he to forsake her father's house? He had disappointed his father and his family members. He had disappointed them. What will he go and tell them now? What will he go and say? But there's one thing he did which you should do. Very important. And that is courage. Courage. He summoned courage to return and confess his folly. Maybe he will be pardoned by his father. He summoned courage. Don't be so disappointed that you will not come back. God is merciful. God is merciful. Backslider, don't think that God will have forgotten you. He has not. He thinks about you. He's looking for when you will come back. When you will return, abandon all those hypocritical lives. Abandon that type of life of destitution. And remember that your father is waiting for you. So, this man summoned courage and returned back to his father to seek for pardon. He had wasted his inheritance as a son and now sought the place of a hired servant in his father's house. Yes, I can't come and boast for a son even and say I am a son anymore. I've collected my property. I've eaten my own share of food. I've wasted it. I am coming not just as a servant, a hired servant. Inasmuch as I can have food to eat, I can have a house to sleep. Now I'm sleeping under trees. I'm sleeping under the bridge. I have no place. If I can have food to eat, I can have a house to live in. I can have people that will talk with me now. Nobody even agrees to come closer and talk. People have that pretended. They're not sincere with me. They're not original. Because what would they gain in my life? But in my father's house, the servants that are there are at peace. They laugh with one another. They talk. They share things together. Please, let me go and be a servant. So, he now decided to return back to his father's house. Now, the father is a sympathetic person. The father is a loving person. The father is a caring person. But the father, when the father saw him coming, the father ran to him. God embraced him. Happy with him. Oh, my son has come back home. This my son was lost. Now I found him. Dead and is alive now. So, the father was so happy. The father embraced him. He confessed actually. Oh, father, I have done sin against heaven. I've sinned against thee. I'm not worthy to be called your son. But the riches of the father cannot be exhausted. The father has enough for him to renew his sonship and make him enjoy rights, equal rights. Yes, the right of sonship can be restored back to him. So, the father said, remove the rags and put on a garment of him upon him. Righteousness. Remove this rags. Put on shoes upon him. Put on a garment upon him. Show a signet of authority as a son to his father. The ring. Put it upon him, as according to the tradition of those times. Put it upon him. That's what the father did. Now, he received acceptance. The father made all other people, call his neighbors, call the other servants, kill the fatted calf and let's rejoice. My son has come back. My son has come back. My son has come back. So likewise, the God of heaven will do. If you will come back, if you return to him, you are a great minister of God, you backslide, if you will come back. Joy will be in heaven because of you. You are a useful child of God. God loves you. He loves you. See what you have done for him. See what you promised. And see what God promised even to do for you. To use you to do. But how could the devil carry you like that? Sin deceived you. Now God is ready to forgive you. Restore you. Restore righteousness back to you. Restore sonship back to you. Restore the Christian ministry back to you. Restore, pour anointing upon you and bring you back to usefulness. If you can come to the Father, if you will come again, the Lord will receive you. Now, the third is the case of the publican. The publican. In Luke chapter 18, verse 9 to 14. The publican. Luke chapter 18, verse 9 2, verse 14. The Bible tells us here, saying, "And he spake this parable unto Satan, which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Two men went up into the temple to pray, the one a Pharisee and the other a publican. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, 'God, I thank thee that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. I fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all that I possess.' And the publican, standing afar off, would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, 'God, be merciful to me, a sinner.' I tell you, this man went down to his house justified, rather than the other. For everyone that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted." Here we see the case of pride and the case of humility. The other man, the Pharisee, was a proud man. And you know, the proud man will only present the good side of his life. He has the evil side. He will not show the evil side because his glory will go away. People will start laughing at him. So, he will show the good side of his life and hide the evil side. Such a person cannot receive forgiveness of sins. He will not acknowledge that he is a sinner. He will not acknowledge that he is a sinner and that God shall forgive him. No, he is righteous already. Look at this publican here that was already showing his righteousness, saying, I do this, I fast twice in a week, I give alms, I do this, I am righteous, and hit his own issue. And was even condemning that publican there. I'm not even as that publican is. Can you see pride? And pride will, the Bible says, he that exalts himself shall be humbled. God will push him down. God will deny him repentance. God will deny him righteousness. God will deny him forgiveness. God will deny him holiness experience. Why? Because he's a proud man. Don't agree to be proud. Please, the fact that you are a minister of the gospel, you are a worker in the church, you are a leader in the church, does not mean you may not have sin in your life or that you cannot sin. So that you are now hiding yourself. You're only wanting to show the good part of yourself. And so, cheating yourself. Denying yourself of the forgiveness of God. Of original righteousness. Which if you had humbled and come before God. Even humbled and submit to him. Even publicly humbled and say, "Lord, have mercy on me, on a sinner. You would have received forgiveness of sins. Your life would have been original. Instead of the hypocrisy you're playing and waiting for hellfire. So, but check this boy, this man's case now. He was humble. You know, publicans, tax collectors, as Zacchaeus, you could see, they were rich people. They had the authority of the government behind them. They were rich. They had money. Don't this man have some good works to have presented? You mean he didn't give gifts of money to people who, since they had all this money? He didn't do good to people? He did good to people's lives. Yes. He did good. But he did not present the good. What good can dirty money do in this life before God? You carry dirty money. Can somebody fetch dirty water for you and say he has given you a gift? He has done you a good thing? Fetching dirty water for you to drink? Our righteousness outside Christ are filthy rags. So this man had no righteousness to present. He came before God. He will not even as much as lift up his eyes to heaven. Why? Let not his eyes come in contact with the Holy God. It's not worthy. How would he bear this God? He bowed down his head and was smote upon his chest. "Lord, have mercy upon me. I am a sinner. Lord, have mercy." This man was busy pointing to his direction and condemning him. That means nothing. You are telling the truth, man, that I am a sinner. Yes, I am. I agree. I have seen even more than you. I have seen more than everybody else. But merciful God, have mercy upon me. I am a sinner. So, God, that's what God likes. And the Bible says, heaven forgave him. God forgave him. The merciful God forgave him. The God that is pleased with humility forgave him. What you need in your life to bring forgiveness to yourself from God is humility. Humility. God loves the humble man. God hears the prayers of the humble man. God saves the humble man. God exalts the humble man. God frees the humble man. If you can humble and come to this God and bring your sin to him, he will forgive you. As he did to this publican, he will do to you. And that's what I am requesting. Come before God. Humble yourself. You will see you'll be a new man. The original Christianity will be your portion in Jesus' name. Now, number four, the infirm man met Paul, another man. John chapter 5, verse 5 to 9, and verse 14. John chapter 5, verse 5 to verse 9, and verse 14. And a certain man was there, which had an infirmity, 38 years. When Jesus saw him lie, and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, "Wilt thou be made whole?" The impotent man answered him, "Sir, I have no man. When the water is troubled, to put me into the pool. But while I am coming, another steppeth down before me." Jesus said unto him, "Rise, take up thy bed, and walk." And immediately the man was made whole, and took up his bed, and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. Verse 14. Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple, and said unto him, can we read that together? 1, 2, go. "Behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more, lest a worse thing come upon thee." Can you see something here? Sin brought sickness to this man and wasted him away for about 38 years. You can see the poison of sin. That thing that deceives you and say it is sweet in the name of immorality. Can you see how it can retard your life? Can you see how it can confuse your life? Can you see how it can stop any progress in your life? Can you see how it can reduce your life? Can you see how it can incapacitate your life? 38 years. One sin did it for that man. How did it happen? That sin, deceitful pleasures of sin, it is sweet in your mouth, but when it goes down, it becomes bitter and stomach ulcer starts. Sin meant to lay hold on him to the end. 38 years. The man was still wasting away. It didn't leave him after 5 years. It didn't leave him after 10. It didn't leave him after 15, after 20, 25. 38. And sin was on a journey of eternal wastage. A journey of eternal wastage in this life and in the life to come. Sin. What a wonder when you are delivered out of it. What a blessing when you are delivered out of it from the hand of that madman. What a grace. Jesus showed that his sickness was the repercussion of his sins. Sin no more, lest a worse thing. It was your sin that brought this. It was your sin that resulted to this. Now you have been saved out of it. If you go back, that thing will come back. Worse. Yes. Unfortunate. As long as the sin remains unforgiven, untreated, his woes remained. Let not that sin be exposed. Let not that sin be confessed. Let that sin receive your personal management. That problem remains. Didn't you hear that the most miserable case is the case of sin? The most hopeless case is the case of sin. You're hopelessly managing that thing. It's hopeless. You can't arrive at result. You can't. Others are helping you to cover it up. That's hopeless case. They can't arrive at solution. The Savior came to him out of divine mercy and removed the sin from his life and healed him. Wave that hand before the Lord. Just wave it. Thank you, Jesus. Just tell him, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. This is good. This is mercy. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. So, 38 years, wasted life, got changed, got renewed, got liberated by the encounter with the Almighty Savior. Meet with Jesus today. Meet with the Savior today. Your misery will come to an end. The power that has gotten hold of you shall be broken. Those demons shall be driven out of your life. Meet with Jesus today. There shall be a change. You will rise, pick up your bed and walk as normal man. That's the Savior. Present Jesus to people. Present Jesus to people. That's the Savior. Come unto me. I make a difference in your life. For I am God and beside me there's none else. I am your Savior. The man became free. Yes. He received from God the power to go and sin no more. To live and sin no more. Because those words, sin no more, is a living word. The words are alive. They go to work in that man. This hearing that you're hearing of faith, if you believe, those words will produce life in your life. You'll find that the power of sin will be broken in Christ. He is the power of God and the wisdom of God. Hallelujah. Now, look at another person. The woman caught in adultery. I'm telling you, cases of forgiveness of sins. Why? So that no sin will remain in your life. It's the problem of the world. It's the problem of nations. It's the problem of homes and families. It's what affects marriages. It's what affects brothers and brothers. Brothers and sisters. Sisters and sisters. It's the thing affecting neighbors. Business partners, sin. In John chapter 8, verse 1 to verse 11. John chapter 8, verse 1 to 11. Jesus went unto the Mount of Olives. And early in the morning, he came again into the temple, and all the people came unto him. And he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and Sadducees and Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they say unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us,